Walter Cronkite. No man's life encompasses the great events that are the life of Sir Winston Churchill. Today, the first of two episodes of Churchill, Man of the Century. Part one, The Years of Challenge. In the 20th century, in the summer of 1940, the supreme challenge came to Britain and to Winston Leonard Spencer Churchill.
Deutsche Kampfflugzeuge vom Typ Heinkel 111 fliegen gegen England. Achtung, englische Jäger, Feuer aus den Rohren!
The battle of Britain is about to begin. Upon this battle depends the survival of Christian civilization. The whole fury and might of the enemy must very soon be turned on us. Hitler knows that he will have to break us in this island or lose the war. Let us therefore brace ourselves to our duty. So bear ourselves that if the British Empire and its Commonwealth last for a thousand years, men will still say, this was their finest hour. I have not always been wrong about the future of events, and if you will permit me, I shall inscribe some of these words as my testament, because I should like to be held accountable for them in years which I shall not see.
In the long life of Winston Churchill, there have been many moments, great, tragic, poignant. One of the most poignant for him personally was an evening in 1955 when he was about to step down for the last time as Prime Minister, his work done. Britain's young Queen, Elizabeth II, paid him the singular honor of dining with him at No. 10 Downing Street. Who was this man the Queen came to honor? What forces shaped his career?
I'm a child of the House of Commons. I was brought up in my father's house to believe in democracy, trust the people. That was his message, way back in those aristocratic Victorian days when, as Disraeli said, the world was for the few and for the very few.
His first monarch was also a queen, Victoria. For 63 years, this redoubtable woman ruled a Britain that enjoyed comparative peace, great prosperity, and unrivaled world power. Great houses were part of the life of Victorian England. This is Blenheim Palace, where Churchill was born, November 30th, 1874. A massive estate of 2,700 acres, Blenheim was built in the early 18th century with public money for John Churchill, the first Duke of Marlborough. Churchill's parents lived here, though they did not own the castle. His father was Sir Randolph Churchill, who rose in a brief meteoric career to be England's Chancellor of the Exchequer. Jenny Jerome, his mother, was a famous New York beauty who gave Winston his American connection. 1877, he was three. As a boy, he was difficult, often disobedient. The mistress of his dancing class said of him, "I used to think he was the naughtiest small boy in the world." At 12, he entered Harrow, and being a rebel, would not pose with his class. He did not distinguish himself. He flubbed Latin and mathematics, But Winston, the youngster, had left, in his own words, got into my bones the essential structure of the ordinary British sentence, which is a noble thing. Then to Sandhurst, Britain's West Point. Cadet Churchill, age 18. Commissioned a second lieutenant, he served as a soldier and newspaper reporter in five minor wars, the first of them being an insurrection in Cuba in 1895. The next year found him in India, playing polo, fighting the Pathan tribesmen, writing a bad novel, and reading Gibbon. Then on to the Sudan with Kitchener and the Battle of Omdurman against the Dervishes, probably the last great cavalry charge in history. Churchill, 24, resigned from the army, donned a war correspondent's uniform, and was off to South Africa. Here, the Boers, early Dutch settlers, were fighting to keep their independence from British control. Churchill plunged into the fray. Churchill was captured and slapped into prison. He quickly escaped, and the Boers offered a £25 reward for him, dead or alive. Englishman, talks through his nose, cannot pronounce the letter S properly. Churchill, by then safe, whipped off a flamboyant dispatch to London to reassure the world. 1900, a now famous Churchill, who had rolled a lifetime of experience into his 25 years, was elected as a Conservative member of the House of Commons.
For us in Britain, the 19th century ended amid the glories of the Victorian era. And we entered upon the dawn of the 20th in high hope for our country, our empire, and the world.
In prosperous Conservative Britain, Churchill soon turned maverick. He broke with party leader Joseph Chamberlain, who opposed free trade and cheap food for the working man. Chamberlain loves the working man, he quipped. He loves to see him work. In 1904, he joined the rapidly rising Liberal Party under Lloyd George. As a Liberal, Churchill plumped for a British New Deal, improved working conditions, old age pensions, Social Security. He drew the line, however, at women voting, and in 1908 he was temporarily unseated because of his opposition to the suffragettes. Opposition to women's suffrage did not make him an anti-feminist. On September 12, 1908, at the age of 33, he married a beautiful aristocrat, Clementine Hozier, and in his own words, lived happily ever afterwards. Despite his political involvements, he never lost his appetite for action. While Home Secretary in the Cabinet in 1911, some anarchists broke loose in London and holed up in a tenement in Sydney Street. Although this should have remained a police matter, Churchill leaped in and directed operations like an old campaigner. In the same year, this building, the Admiralty, opened to him a much bigger opportunity. At 36, he became First Lord and fought for the money that would keep Britain supreme in the naval race against Germany. He was back in his military element, a world of great ships, guns, and armor plate. In three decisive years, he flung money into new battleships, cleared out the Admiralty's deadwood, and converted the fleet from coal to oil. In 1914, as World War I was breaking, he put the fleet to sea on his own responsibility. As Lord Kitchener later said to him, "Well, Winston, there is one thing they cannot take from you. The fleet was ready." In 1915, Churchill supported the Gallipoli campaign. A strike at the Dardanelles designed to knock Turkey out of the war, outflank Germany, and aid Imperial Russia. He saw in the mobility of Allied sea power the answer to the brutal stalemate on the Western Front. Sound in strategy, the plan was dogged by dissension, and Churchill was forced to resign from the Admiralty. When finally launched, a British and Australian land invasion was repulsed at Gallipoli with 250,000 casualties. As original proponent for the campaign, Churchill caught the blame. The very word Gallipoli haunted him for the rest of his career. At 40, when most men's fortunes are reaching their peak, Churchill, who had risen so fast, was plunged into despair. He told a friend, "I am finished." What he could. Went to France, served his regiment in the trenches. Returning at Lloyd George's behest to be Minister of Munitions, he enthusiastically pressed for a new instrument of war, the tank. He found it the most exciting weapon since the battleship. Not without difficulty, he won his battle for tank production. Tanks were better than hurling flesh against flesh in Flanders mud. They gave the offense what he called moving power. Minister of Munitions, he came to know the factory floor and the hard, basic economics of war. Equally important, he saw the potentialities of the airplane. He learned to fly, piloted his own plane to France on inspection trips, walked away from a couple of crack-ups, and scoffed at those who thought a cabinet minister ought to stay on the ground. He watched the air war with keen interest. Now he was not just amphibious, but tri-amphibious. He knew the land, the sea, and the air. Armistice brought jubilation to London, but Churchill's thoughts ranged thousands of miles away. A chill and ominous wind blowing out of Russia, where the Tsar had been deposed in 1917, and the Bolsheviks had seized power in Moscow. Now, in 1918, in Vladivostok, the Allies, including a United States force, were intervening in a last-ditch attempt to stop communism. Churchill threw himself enthusiastically into this attempt and was roundly criticized. Osbert Sitwell wrote, "Who is more qualified to lead a retreat than the victor of Gallipoli, Antwerp, and Sydney Street?" But as events proved, Churchill, not his critics, had taken the true measure of communism and its leader, Nikolai Lenin.
Comrades Red Army men, the capitalists of England, America, and France are waging war against Russia. They are sending money and military supplies to the Russian landowners who are leading troops from Siberia, the Don, and the North Caucasus against the Soviet power.
The failure to strangle Bolshevism at its birth and to bring Russia then prostrate by one means or another into the general democratic system lies heavy upon us today.
His belligerent opposition to communism and socialism not only brought criticism, but also cost votes. Defeated as a liberal candidate for parliament, he ran twice again as an independent. He was beaten both times, the second time by this gentleman. In 1924, a disillusioned Churchill returned to the Conservative Party which he had left 18 years before, was given a safe seat in Commons, and was made Chancellor of the Exchequer by Stanley Baldwin. He put Britain back on the gold standard only to see the country plunge into a general strike and then depression. In 1929, the Labour Party under Socialist Ramsay MacDonald took over. Churchill was out, not to return to power for a decade. He was 54. For him, this was the void. Bricklaying became a curious hobby during the bleak years of depression. He painted, he wrote, and in his lectures he despaired of Britain's declining position, drifting to and fro on the tides in a deeply disturbed ocean. Occasionally he got some recognition, but mostly he was a discouraged and forlorn figure. An event in Germany, the rise of Adolf Hitler, to restore purpose to Britain's forgotten man. He must warn his country, and holding a seat in Parliament was a means to sound the general alarm.
Just announce the result. Mr. Churchill's figures are 35,956, Mr. Comyn's Carter 15,670, Mr. Ranger, 4,713. Hooray! I therefore declare Mr. Churchill duly elected a member for Parliament for the Epping Division of the County of Essex.
Britain slept on. Its people, beginning to taste better times, were absorbed in domestic affairs. Alone, unpopular, Churchill fought back in written articles, in sharp and penetrating speeches.
At present we lie within a few minutes striking distance of the French, Dutch, and Belgian coast, and within a few hours of the great aerodromes of Central Europe. We are even within cannon shot of the continent. So close as that. It is prudent, it is possible, however we might desire it, to turn our backs upon Europe and ignore whatever may happen there. I hope, I pray, and on the whole, grasping the larger hope, I believe that no war will fall upon us. But if in the near future the great war of 1914 is resumed again in Europe after the armistice, for that is what it may come to, under different conditions no doubt, in differing combinations no doubt, if that should happen, no one can tell where and how it would end, or whether, sooner or later, we should not be dragged into it.
You see these dictators on their pedestals, surrounded by the bayonets of their soldiers and the truncheons of their police. Yet in their hearts, there is unspoken, unspeakable fear. They are afraid of words and thoughts, words spoken abroad, thoughts stirring at home, all the more powerful because forbidden. These terrify them. A little mouse, a little tiny mouse of thought appears in the room, and even the mightiest potentates are thrown into panic.
September 1938, Prime Minister Chamberlain went to Munich to sacrifice Czechoslovakia for peace in our time. Churchill stood up in the House of Commons and called the pact a total and unmitigated defeat. At Churchill's apartment, Lord Robert Cecil and Harold Nicholson met with him to discuss the pact further. Says Nicholson of this meeting,
And we went through it, and we all agreed that it meant nothing at all. It was absolutely meaningless. And so then Lord Robert Cecil said, well, Winston, I don't know what you feel. I feel in despair. And Winston, sitting there, said, yes, Bob, I feel in despair unutterable. I feel 20 years younger. And I went away thinking, that's a chap for me.
We must arm. Britain must arm. America must arm. Of course we shall do it in the end. We shall sure do it. But how much harder our toil for every day's delay.
At last the nation listened. It was late. By September 3rd, 1939, Britain was at war. Churchill returned as First Lord of the Admiralty, and British ships flashed, Winston is back. For Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain, the sands were running out. The British fiasco in Norway, followed by Hitler's strike into Belgium, forced his resignation. At 65, with a lifetime of preparation behind him, Winston Churchill entered number 10 Downing Street.
To you for the first time as Prime Minister in a solemn hour for the life of our country, of our empire, of our allies, and above all, of the cause of freedom. A tremendous battle is raging in France and Flanders. The Germans, by a remarkable combination of air bombing and heavily armored tanks, have broken through the French defenses north of the Maginot Line, and strong columns of their armored vehicles are ravaging the open country, which for the first day or two was without defenders. If this is one of the most awe-striking periods in the long history of France and Britain, it is also, beyond doubt, the most sublime. Behind them, behind us, behind the armies and fleets of Britain and France, gather a group of shattered states and bludgeoned races, the Czechs, the Poles, the Norwegians, the Danes, the Dutch, the Belgians, upon all of whom the long night of barbarism will descend, unbroken even by a star of hope, unless we conquer, and conquer we must, and conquer we shall.
To be no easy conquest. Dunkirk presented him in his first days as Prime Minister with an appalling disaster. The British expeditionary force in France, driven back to the Channel, seemed to face certain annihilation. Churchill flashed the order, forget about the equipment. We can rebuild that. We can't remake men. To save the men, he ordered anything that could float to the Dunkirk beaches. Brighton puddle jumpers, motor launches, tiny sailboats. 350,000 British and French were miraculously evacuated. To those who counted this a victory, Churchill growled, "Wars are not won by evacuations." Into fallen Dunkirk rolled the triumphant Germans. With France collapsing, he fought desperately to salvage the remains, especially the French fleet. 5 times he flew to the continent, and even after the French surrendered, he implored them to reassemble their forces and fight on.
Français, c'est moi, Churchill, qui vous parle. Pendant plus de 30 ans, dans la paix comme dans la guerre, j'ai marché avec vous et je marche encore avec vous aujourd'hui. Allons, bonne nuit. Dormez bien, rassemblez vos forces pour l'aube, car l'aube viendra, elle se lèvera, brillante pour les braves, douce pour les fidèles qui auront souffert, glorieuse sur les tombeaux des héros. Vive la France!
Germany's great air strike against Britain, directed by Hermann Goering, reached its climax in September 1940. Then Goering blundered. Instead of continuing his telling attacks on British Air Force installations and radar stations, he decided he could break Britain by smashing at its cities. In London, in Liverpool, in Birmingham, in Coventry, the British people, whom Churchill had promised nothing but blood, toil, tears, and sweat, waited.
Indiscriminate bombings of London are, of course, a part of Hitler's invasion plan. Little did he know the spirit of the British nation or the tough fiber of the Londoner. This wicked man, the repository and embodiment of many forms of soul-destroying hatred, this monstrous product of former wrongs and shame has now resolved to try to break our famous island race by a process of indiscriminate slaughter and destruction.
Wherever the damage was worst, Churchill appeared, symbol of British fortitude. But while outwardly resolute, he confessed to a friend, "Poor people. Poor people, they trust me, and I've given them nothing but disaster." Next week at this time, the second installment of Churchill, Man of the Century. Part 2, The Years of Triumph. This is Walter Cronkite. Last week, we presented the first chapter of Churchill, Man of the Century, The Years of Challenge. which ended with Britain and the free world in mortal peril. Today we present part two, the years of triumph. Disaster on the ground, Britain was saved in the air by the RAF in one of the decisive battles of history.
In July, August, and September 1940, 40 or 50 squadrons of British fighter aircraft in the Battle of Britain broke the teeth of the German air fleet at odds of 7 or 8. Never in the field of human conflict was so much owed by so many to so few.
June 1941. They still beleaguered Britain, got a windfall. Hitler attacked Russia. Despite his lifelong hatred of communism, Churchill promised full support for the Soviets. There was only one enemy.
We cannot yet see how deliverance will come, or when it will come. But nothing is more certain than that every trace of Hitler's footsteps, every stain of his infected and corroding fingers will be sponged and purged, and if need be, blasted from the surface of the earth.
August of 1941, under conditions of great secrecy, he made an historic voyage across the Atlantic on the battleship Prince of Wales. The victory of the RAF and Hitler's lunge into Russia had helped his cause. But to win, he must bring the new world, in his own words, to the liberation and rescue of the old. He needed the United States, its money, its arms, its industrial power. At Placentia Bay, Newfoundland, he would meet President Franklin D. Roosevelt face to face for the first time as Prime Minister. And he knew that everything depended on how they would get along. History dwells on the two statesmen signing the famous Atlantic Charter, a declaration of principle. Of far greater importance was the fact that off the foggy banks of Newfoundland, an Englishman and an American struck it off and came to understand each other. Back in England, he rallied his own workers. But despite Britain's effort, public opinion in the United States remained divided. It took an event 7,000 miles away to fulfill Churchill's dream, a firm and fighting American ally. On December 7th, 1941, the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor. Britain declared war on Japan in a matter of hours, and he hurried to Washington. At a joint session of Congress, he thundered out against the Germans and Japanese and made the most of his personal American connection.
By the way, I cannot help but reflect that if my father had been American and my mother British, instead of the other way around, I might have got here on my own. What kind of a people do they think we are? Is it possible they do not realize that we shall never cease to persevere against them until they have been taught a lesson which they and the world will never forget?
From Washington, he went to Ottawa, where he told the Canadian Parliament of his attempts to keep France in the war.
When I warned them that Britain would fight on alone, whatever they did, their general told their prime minister and his divided cabinet, in 3 weeks, England will have her neck wrung like a chicken. Some chicken. Some neck.
Another ally was giving him trouble. August of 1942 found him in Moscow to tell the insistent Russians that instead of a second front in Europe, there would be an Allied invasion of North Africa. With Churchill was the British Chief of Staff, Lord Allenbrooke. The pleasantries of the public meeting soon evaporated when Churchill told Stalin that there could be no second front yet. North Africa was a success. The tide of the war was beginning to turn. In 1943, Churchill visited General Montgomery. The troops responded to the old trooper. In the following months, there were other meetings. Casablanca, Tehran, Cairo, Yalta. Conferences where the victory was planned, but where the promise of a secure and just peace was to elude the statesmen. In Churchill's phrase, triumph and tragedy. Victory was the invasion of Europe. Spring of 1940, first-time foreigners in a strange city, aimlessly wandering the streets. Ahead, D-Day and the invasion of Europe. But today, tonight, well, what do you do on a last flight?
The hour of our greatest effort and action is approaching. And when the signal is given, the whole circle of avenging nations will hurl themselves upon the foe and batter out the life of the cruelest tyranny which has ever sought to bar the progress of mankind.
Churchill intended to watch the Normandy bombardment from a cruiser on D-Day. Only the personal intervention of the king dissuaded him. On D+4, he set foot on French soil for the first time in 4 years. And as the battles were fought and the armies streamed across Europe, he followed them toward victory. May 8, 1945, the end of the war in Europe. Weary and worn, impoverished but undaunted and now triumphant, wrote Churchill, we had a moment that was sublime. Months later, the big three conference at Potsdam. Roosevelt had died, the cherished friendship was over. With Harry Truman and Joseph Stalin, he still entertained high hopes for the peace. Then, as it happened so often in his lifetime, he suffered a crushing reverse. Laborite Clement Attlee defeated him at the polls. All our enemies having surrendered, Churchill wrote, I was immediately dismissed by the British electorate from all further conduct of their affairs. It was the void again, enforced idleness. 70 years old, he took a conventional holiday. He did not remain idle long. There was his painting, which he had first taken up when he had been fired from the British Admiralty at the time of Gallipoli, and at which he has real talent. Too old for polo, he could get some satisfaction out of owning racehorses. Above all, he could return to his writing. For 50 years, it has been his inner resource. In the dark days during and after World War I, he had written his famous 6-volume history, The World Crisis. Now, while conservatives were lamenting his defeat, he was busy writing his 6-volume history of World War II. There were public honors, too. The French remembered Churchill.
Premier ministre Winston Churchill, la France vous remercie.
These occasions gave him an opportunity to speak out on vital issues. Communism, Germany, the atom. At Fulton, Missouri in 1946, he called the turn on communism with a famous phrase.
from Stettin in the Baltic to Trieste in the Adriatic, an iron curtain has descended across the continent. Behind that line lie all the capitals of the ancient states of Central and Eastern Europe. Warsaw, Berlin, Prague, Vienna, Budapest, Belgrade, Bucharest, and Sofia. All these famous cities and the populations around them lie in what I must call the Soviet sphere.
And while the Germans were surrendering by hundreds of thousands, and our streets were crowded with cheering people, I telegraphed to Lord Montgomery, directing him to be careful in collecting the German arms which were pouring in great masses, to stack them so that they could easily be issued again to German soldiers whom we should have to work with if the Soviet advance into Western Europe continued. That shows where I was then.
MIT, March 31st, 1949.
I must not conceal from you tonight the truth as I see it. It is certain that Europe would have been communized like Czechoslovakia and London under bombardment some time ago, but for the deterrent of the atomic bomb in the hands.
The old political campaigner, now 76, wanted vindication, too. In 1951, he fought hard for the conservative victory that would return him as prime minister.
I come to you today here with a message, which is, we're going to win. I can feel it in my bones, we're going to win. And now with our lot, you may be quite sure, if you feel tender-hearted about him, that the Labour Party, Socialist Party, or Labour, as they like to call themselves, although they're not the only people who work in this country.
His personal popularity had never faltered, and in a close election, he won his fight. April 1953, Churchill, the great commoner, received one of the rare honors of the British Empire. He became Sir Winston Churchill, Knight Companion of the Most Noble Order of the Garter. Queen Elizabeth, fifth monarch under whom he has served, knighted him just as Queen Anne had honored his great ancestor, John Churchill, Duke of Marlborough. Through all of his ups and downs, world leader and outcast, Churchill has never lost his flash of wit.
Good humor and fun. In my belief, you cannot deal with the most serious things in the world unless you also understand the most amusing. This television has come to take its place in the world. Rather an old-fashioned person, I have not been one of its principal champions, but I don't think it needs any champions. It can make its own way. And it's a wonderful thing, indeed, to think that every expression on my face at this moment may be viewed by millions of people throughout the United States. I hope the raw material is as good as the methods of distribution.
Shall we say something?
Yes.
I thought you understood.
I have been asked to say just 10 words, but I haven't been told which 10 words they should be. But there are 10 words which come very readily to my mind, and that is the great pleasure I have in feeling the genial sunshine of Miami Beach. This is the great pleasure I have in feeling the genial sunshine of Miami Beach. One too many. At the present time, however, I must admit they are doing very useful work where they are, in restraining the featherheads, crackpots, vote catchers, and office seekers from putting the folly they talk into action.
On his 80th birthday at Westminster Hall, members of both houses of Parliament paid Churchill an unprecedented honor. There were tributes by members of all parties and a portrait.
This is, to me, the most memorable public occasion of my life. The portrait is a remarkable example of modern art. Certainly combines force and candor. These are qualities which no active member of either house can do without or should fear to meet. Ladies and gentlemen, I am now nearing the end of my journey. I hope I still have some services to render. However that may be, and whatever may befall, I am sure I shall never forget the emotions of this day or be able fully to express my gratitude to those colleagues and companions with whom I have lived my life for this wonderful honor they have done me.
Was the man the Queen came to visit at number 10 Downing Street in 1955. When will there be another like him?